Hello and also welcome from my side to our session, putting the fun back into functional neuroimaging. My name is Andreas Horn from Berlin, and I will talk about the basal ganglia in 15 minutes. So it's crazy a lot to talk about. So I'll try to be brief, and I will probably scratch the surface on quite some topics only. So quick recap about the basal ganglia, then we'll dive into MRI imaging of the basal ganglia, and then talk briefly about some applications such as deep brain stimulation imaging. If you look at the basal ganglia, they are a set of very small structures in the base of the brain. So from outside, you don't see them. That's why maybe sometimes they get neglected more than they should. And they are small, so hard for imaging, challenge accepted. Let's dive into it. To quickly recap, we conventionally call the chordate, putamen, and nucleus accumbens together as the striatum. It's one of the main input structures of the basal ganglia. Then we have the external and internal pallidum. Again, a very important structure in the basal ganglia. The subthalamic nucleus, very important for clinical applications such as deep brain stimulation and Parkinson's disease. And then we have the reticular and compact part of the substantia nigra. And together, these are the like conventional parts of the basal ganglia. You cannot talk about them without talking about loops. So you have motor, associative, and limbic loops. Sometimes you have also premotor and oculomotor loops. So going from the cortex over the striatum, through the pallidum, then back to the thalamus and back up. And you could also subdivide, let's say, the motor loop into somatotopic loops. For example, I have a leg loop, an arm loop, a face loop, and so on for the motor system. So, you know, these loops are models as always, and they can be helpful, but they are not a final grain of postulation that we can apply. And if you follow the nomenclature and concepts of Larry Swanson, you could even postulate the whole brain into a cortex, striatum, and pallidum region with always these excitation, inhibition, and then disinhibition functions. So Larry Swanson would postulate all other cerebral nuclei into either striatum and pallidum as well. So he uses these terms a bit more generalized. And to show you what that means, these two loops are basically the dorsal and ventral striatum loops that we know of. But these other loops use different structures to have the same function of the striatum and pallidum. So potentially this general idea of that basic circuit could be translated across the whole brain. Then looking more focused again on the basal ganglia, very important are these box and arrow models, especially the one by Alvin and DeLong from around 1990 that some of you have surely seen already in med school or somewhere else. Then from the computational side, Gurney, Prescott, and Redgrave created a model that I think is very important as well, which had this notion that the direct pathway is prokinetic and the indirect pathway is antikinetic. So the idea of, you know, one pro movement and one against movement. And this has evolved a lot, but is still useful sometimes. So then these are the structures again. So you have these direct and indirect and also hyperdirect pathways that functionally play a role. And these have been very influential. I must say also that these wiring diagrams are much older than the 1990s. For example, the Vogts created similar drawings in 1922. So as always, science history repeats itself and we often neglect what has been discussed 50 years ago already. What is the current state of the art? If you ask, I think one of the basal ganglia experts, Hage Bergmann, whom you can see here looking at intraoperative data, and who just wrote a really nice book about the basal ganglia that I must recommend. It's really fascinating, will be out soon. You can look at his most modern version of the box and arrow plots, where you can see the classical basal ganglia main axis integrated into a reinforcement actor-critic model that receives dopamine, but also input from other neurotransmitters and modulators to like shape the basal ganglia activity. But then you have to, when you go to neuroimaging, you have to translate these functional models into anatomical domain, which is not even straightforward. This is my attempt that you can see here. So this is again, this main axis of the basal ganglia going through Wilson's pencils, through the striatum, through the pallidum, and then through the internal capsule in form of the Edinger's comb system to the STNN substantia nigra. And then there's the paleothalamic outflow fibers that go back up through the thalamus and back to the cortex, right? So if we want to model and image that, we need a good anatomical definition of these structures as well. And one more integrated attempt that I really love and also must recommend by my co-speaker, Mac Shine here, is really a must read about the basal ganglia and cerebellar integration via the thalamus. So in his new concept from just 2020, the thalamus has the ability to integrate information from basal ganglia and cerebellum and modulate the cortical repertoire based on these inputs. So that is a more anatomical and more, you know, directly applicable functional concept that should be explored more. The basal ganglia also form as a dimensionality reduction system, which you can literally see here on this beautiful image by Marcus Axa, polarized light imaging, a section of a coronal slice through the brain of a vertebrate monkey, actually. So these are Wilson's pencils that I talked about going through the putamen, and then you have some rewiring in the external lamina, then they go parallel again in the external pallidum, then some rewiring again, then you have again parallel fibers in the GPI, rewiring, and then parallel fibers in the internal part of the GPI. So you can literally see how, you know, cortical information gets compressed to a smaller space, and then it goes through the thalamus back up and gets expanded again, just as in many machine learning applications that we study these days. A problem though with imaging is that the resolution is too poor, right? This is what we just saw, and this is our resolution that we usually have in optimal imaging sequences, right? So we don't see things. What can we do to improve that at least a bit? So on 3 Tesla, you can basically use 2 strategies. One focuses on iron, one on myelin. With 2 example applications here, this is quantitative susceptibility imaging, which is really good for the iron dense structures such as the SDN and the red nucleus. And you also see the answer here and, you know, some other structures. And then the myelin structures are really good for the pallidum, but also for the thalamus. So here you can see the lamina dividing the internal and external pallidum, and then the one dividing it from the striatum, from the putamen. And inside the thalamus, the same sequence gives you quite some resolvence of the thalamic nucleus. So there it can be really helpful as well. Beyond 3 Tesla, you can go to 7 Tesla, of course. This is my brain, scanned by Todd Harrington, John Polimeni at the Martino Center. And you can see these comp system fibers that I talked about. This is a comparison of a dark field microscopy section by Eduardo Aglio, where you can also see these comp system fibers here. Now, even beyond 7 Tesla, in vivo imaging is, of course, ex vivo imaging. And this is one scan that's remarkable. I'll talk about it more in this next slide. But if you just compare the two, there's so much more detail in the ex vivo scan. And this scan was spearheaded, or the project led by Brian Edlow and the team at the Martino Center again. And they built a custom coil and they scanned a beautiful brain over a whole weekend. And that data set is openly available. It's amazing just to look at anatomy, just as a reference image. So be sure to download it and look it up. And it can now be used to as a like optimal definition of anatomy of this region. So this is the integration of that scan into our software Lead TBS, where we can now look at, you know, electrode placement relative to such a reference scan with all these details in between these small structures. So atlas resources are yet another way to study the basal ganglia, because if we cannot image them as precisely in vivo, maybe at least we can use some atlas resources to define them. And I think the team by Beate Forstmann also did a great job in pioneering this approach. We also created one atlas that's part of LEAD-TBS together with Louis Collins and Mala Chakravarti from the M&I, which has histological sections, but also subthalamic nucleus subdivisions based on tractography and so on. So it tries to, you know, take the information that we have to best define the basal ganglia as a whole. And then once you have these atlas structures, how can you make use of them in the individual brain, right? We can, of course, normalize brains. Everybody knows that, and we did here. But we can now use a new software called Warp Drive to refine these normalizations at the regions that we're really interested in. So it's a bit like Photoshop for the brain. You can zoom in, you can say, I'm really interested in the subthalamic nucleus, and I want to slightly refine the ant's warp field by 2 millimeters to the left. And I use my mouse to nudge it in place. So this is the subthalamic nucleus now that you can see, and you can directly compare the outlines of an atlas that could be from histology, from, you know, your brain atlas, with your normalized patient's brain. And you can use the mouse, you know, and then slightly nudge it, as you can see right now, on a warp field level. That could also be used to make the match between histological data and MRI data better, such as here a whole brain section of histology by Eduardo Aglio, that we used Warp Drive to then manually refine the fit to the MRI brain with that. You can see that this is an MRI atlas, and this is the histological section. So we draw a line, and then warp field nudges it to the atlas. By doing that, we can create these, you know, playgrounds of high resolution resources that can be precisely matched to our patients' brains. And then we can use these, you know, in vivo, but also ex vivo atlas resources together to study the patients. Another option to define then white matter tracts in the basal ganglia region is histological mesh tractography, also introduced by Eduardo Aglio. And he used that method on histology to basically study these very thin, small bundles between, let's say, the subthalamic nucleus and the pallidum. Of course, we can also use diffusion MRI, but we have to be really meticulous about it, a bit like Eric Mittelbrooks did here, to manually define and trace these a priori known tracts. That's yet another atlas that's openly available within LeetDBS. So you can use that to, you know, augment what you can see in the individual patient. And of course, we can use techniques like polarized light imaging, as we've seen this picture before. So in my view, the optimal conclusion is here to integrate and combine resources of the in vivo part from your specific brain of study with atlas data. And we need good techniques such as warp drive to fuse them together. Now, quickly, a bit about the application side of things. I mentioned I will talk about the brain stimulation quite a lot. So here, millimeters really matter. That's why it's the optimal example to highlight why all this precision is necessary. You can see two deep brain stimulation electrodes here that are just 2 millimeters apart from each other. This is an optimal stimulation site within that small structure of the subthalamic nucleus that I talked about. And the one that's closer to it led to 80% of improvement in clinical outcomes. The one that's further apart of it, only to 25%. And again, that's just 2 millimeters difference. So we need good imaging, the best we have, to resolve these differences in the first place. We used to define optimal tracts as well, a technique called DBS fiber filtering, where we basically can attribute fiber tract activations based on clinical outcomes. So we can filter which tracts were optimally engaged with the top responding patients. And we have done so in, to just name one example, in a larger cohort of 50 patients with obsessive compulsive disorder. We found out this tract, if you modulate it, patients get better. We made that tract openly available within DTBS, and within 6 months' time, we had like 4 studies that replicated the effects to some degree, right? So we can see that by now, with that precision imaging, we can certainly find models that can be replicated across the globe, actually. And I think as a final outlook option, one goal would be to transfer these precision neuroimaging concepts into the operation room. Here we see a new software again by Simon Oxenford, where we can model where we are in the brain live and trace it to the big brain and to other atlas resources, and then to integrate it with electrophysiological data that we record from the patient. So, you know, we put everything together. We have the great scanning, we have the ultra high field resolution, and then we have warp drive to put them together, and then we can use it in the operation room to really wiggle the millimeters back and forth. So as take homes, I think the basal ganglia are involved in most, if not all, we do. So they are important, probably also to you and to your science. They are challenging for neuroimaging. And I think a combination between in vivo and atlas resources is really fruitful going forward. Deep brain stimulation can open a window into the brain to peek into what's happening down there in these obscure structures. And I think there's high future potential for clinical neuroscience. And again, also for all the imagers out there, there's a clinical need for high resolution data sets. So share your ultra high resolution data sets with us. They can be really helpful to study patients. So thank you very much. This is my team in Berlin. I will be moving to Boston this September, and our lab will be hiring there. So feel free to reach out, check out our lab website, netstim.org, or all these resources that I talked about are, most of them are part of LeadDBS software that you can find here. And there's also a podcast about stimulating brains online available that I curate. So thank you so much for your time. And of course, in the live sessions, we're more than happy to take all your questions. Thank you.